Thank you so much, Kathy. He leadeth me.
Oh, blessed thought.
We're going to start our time together in a word of prayer, and I have asked if Leroy Ristler would lead us before the throne of grace this morning. Leroy, if you would, please.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for a brand new day. Thank you for the beautiful weather outside. Thank you for the blessing that it is to gather together with family in Christ. Thank you for the great teaching that we've already heard this morning. Lord, thank you for your mercy toward us and your kindness, for health after sickness, and for comfort you give us, for the things that life brings. Lord, help us to have our hope in you, and be with us as we continue this day of worship. Teach us, give us what we need. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. I invite you to take your hymnals with me as we join in singing hymn number 51. Hymn number 51, we're going to join together in singing Blessed Assurance. For that singing, you will see in a moment that what we just sang goes hand in hand, or it ought to go hand in hand, with what we are going to take a look at this morning in our call to worship. Our call to worship is taken from three different books of the Bible, all combining a similar theme for us to look at this morning, and we will read through those passages here and get the lay of the land, if you will. 1 Corinthians in chapter 15, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. Hebrews chapter 2. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, that's us, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Romans chapter 1, verse 4, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by resurrection from the dead. Dave Morey said to me this morning, a few moments ago, whew, that call to worship is a feast. And he's right. It is a feast. There's a couple things that I want you to pay attention to this morning as we work our way through this. The first thing is found in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, and it's this thought right here. This is what I want you to fixate on. He also himself took part of the same. Don't lose sight of that. Our future depended on that. Our salvation, our redemption hinged on that fact. He also himself likewise took part of the same. The second thing that I want you to think about is, as you're thinking about that, the next one is, how can it be? How can it be? Romans chapter 3 and verse 23 says, tells us that all mankind has sinned before a holy God. We've rebelled against the one that created us. We have sinned. Romans 6:23 tells us there's a penalty for that sin. That penalty is, class, death. We've sinned. There's a penalty, death. God, by his very nature and character, is perfect. He is just. We see it referred to in Scripture many times as he is righteous. Deuteronomy chapter 32 and verse 4 says, he is the rock. His work is perfect. For all his ways are judgment. A God of truth without iniquity, just and right is he. Psalm 89 verse 14 says, justice and judgment are the habitation of thy throne. That's our God. That is his nature. That is his character. He is perfect. He is just. He is righteous. We can be glad this morning that he is also something else. Because we read about his mercy and his grace and his forgiveness. Exodus 34 verses 6 through 7 says, and the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed to Moses, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. Here's the question for you, class. How can a perfect, just, righteous God act in grace and forgiveness and pardon mankind for his sin? How? we're acquainted with the passage in 2 Timothy 2:13 where we are told God cannot deny himself. God cannot cease being just and perfect and righteous. He also cannot cease from being merciful and gracious and forgiving. How do you synchronize those two things together? We sinned. What is the penalty for sin? Death by man. Mankind had to die. That was the penalty. And this is where you see the beauty of that first phrase that I wanted you to remember. He also himself took part of the same. Took part of what same? Flesh and blood, like you and I. He became man. Do you see how God, if from a human perspective, I like to call this, and give me a little bit of grace when I say this, I call it the divine dilemma. There was no dilemma with God, but from a human perspective, that's what it looks like, a divine dilemma. How do I synchronize these two characters of my nature? I'll become man. Let that sink in. I'll become one of him. And we read in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Why? There was a penalty for our sin that had to be paid by who? Mankind. John chapter 1, verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, for he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. This is why, and this has got to be one of my favorite verses in scripture. This is why in Romans chapter 3, verse 26, we can read this. He might be just and the justifier. He has to punish sin. How can he be gracious and merciful and forgive? How can he also be the justifier? I will become man. I will take upon myself the penalty for mankind's sin by becoming one of them. That's why I wanted you to remember this morning, he also himself likewise took part of the same. An amazing truth for us. We read it in Romans 1, 4, part of our call to worship, and declared to be the Son of God with power. He not only tasted of death, he arose. He conquered it. And all of this led Paul to exclaim in 1 Corinthians 15, if we add one more verse to our call to worship, it starts by saying this. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. And then he says, oh death, where is thy sting? Oh grave, where is thy victory? He became us, and he conquered it for us. One writer says this, the apparent victories of Satan in the Garden of Eden and even in Golgotha were reversed on the cross and vindicated in the resurrection of Christ. From the vantage point of the certain resurrection of the saints, Paul voiced his taunt against death and Satan. Friends, that's what calls us together today as we come before him in worship for all that he is and all that he has done for us. He became like us. How can it be? But yet, that's what we're told. And that's the reality of the truth of this book. May it warm your hearts as you think on that today. It's appropriate then that we turn to our song for the month, hymn number 641, Victory Through Grace. Would you join with me in singing that together?
Bibles and turn with me to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13, I'll be reading verses 3 through 9. And if you would please stand with me in reverence to God's word. Matthew 13, 3 through 9. And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But other fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some an hundredfold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who hath ears to hear? Let him hear. Thank you. You may be seated. We know that God's blessing is upon his word, and so it's with confidence that we can claim that blessing this morning, even in just the hearing of the word, let alone the exposition of the word of God. Let me share with you quickly a couple of announcements. We are not having a ministry of music. Philip and Yira were to be singing, but Philip is on police duty today. And I didn't catch Yira who it is, but I think they said that it's Donald Trump that is in at the Marriott. And so there is need of safety for those who are involved there. So Philip is not here, will not be having that special music. Another time, we'll look forward to that and what the Lord has for us. Board meeting for the board members. Now that's not B-O-R-E-D, so don't all show up on Tuesday night, but it is a time when the members of our board will gather and we have business to take care of. Remember that next Sunday, we need a few people to help with putting things in order to prepare for the painting of the basement that will start the next day, the 28th of October. So let me encourage you, keep it in mind, and we don't need everybody down there, but we will need a few that can help and get things in order. It shouldn't take a tremendous amount of time. You remember the old expression, many hands make light work. We had someone at Practical Bible Training School tell us about an occasion when a man indicated that statement after having asked everybody to raise their hands because the light was not on. And when they did, the light came on, and he said, see, many hands make light work. Well, that's a silly way to put it, but it is something that maybe it will stick with us. There's many needs, and as we work together, we can see that done. You need to be aware of the fact, and I trust that it will be a challenge to your heart to know what the Lord does in our hearts. But our dear Henry, who had to come to the point of saying, I can no longer play the piano and do it effectively, and so he stepped down from being one who participated in our special music. But Henry has shared with me and with John that he has also come to the place and the conclusion and the decision that his time of teaching in the Sunday school hour here at Community Bible Church is done. And so that will give you some basis of understanding why John has decided for the next little bit to go through the series by Brother Congdon on the feasts of Israel, the appointments with God. But Henry, I don't know how we could ever thank you enough for both of those ministries that you've had here in our midst. It's been a joy, it's been a blessing, it's been a delight. And you have effectively ministered both in special music and in the ministry of the word in the Sunday school hour. You've brought in your time two lovely young ladies into this congregation, your first wife, Kathy, and now Doris. And we are so grateful to the Lord for what he has done and is doing, your many years of service. We have not been on the receiving end of all those years of service, but we are blessed to have you in our midst, and we're grateful to God for that. So, Henry, we say goodbye in the teaching ministry with a sadness in our hearts, and yet with an understanding also of those things that God says it's time to end. And he has brought you to that place, and we rejoice with you in what God still has ahead for you and Doris together in ministry and the opportunities he will give one-on-one, and we value your friendship. I think I speak for everyone here, not just myself, when I say that. So thank you. If we feed on God's word daily, considering it more necessary than our daily physical allotment of food, and eating it with a voracious appetite, allowing it to be digested spiritually, to be sustenance for our souls, bringing joy and rejoicing, literally cheerfulness and glee or jubilant delight. And we heed God's word always. We feed on it, reading it. We heed it always. What do you suppose might be that which naturally follows? Stop and think of it as good news. If you have good news, delightful news, wonderful news, what do you want to do with that good news? Share it. You want to share it with somebody else. Someone else needs to know about this good. This is too good to keep to myself. Others have to hear of this. They need to know. If we've received good news, then it's natural that we would want to share it with others. That's what the gospel is, you know. The gospel is literally good news. It's the best news ever. It's the best news that you could possibly ever receive. You can think of all kinds of scenarios where you've said, boy, that's good news. So glad to hear that. There's nothing that can top this good news. It is good news that comes from God, and it has to do with eternal issues. And the very terms that are used in the scriptures verify that reality, that it is good news. Turn with me to Romans chapter 1, verse 16. The Apostle Paul exclaims in this wonderful book of Romans, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek." Building on what Jonathan shared with us in the call to worship this morning, we realize that this is the work that God is doing through his Son, Jesus Christ, whom he sent in human form, in the likeness of men, that he might bring salvation. The word that is used in the Greek text is euangelia, euangelion. It means a good message. It is the gospel, if you will, the good news. And Paul says, I'm not ashamed of this gospel. And that language implies that it required some courage for him to bring to Rome Rome was known as the mistress of the world, the ruler of the world, the place of strength, the place of power. And he brings his message of salvation through Jesus Christ, the power of God unto salvation, to those that believe, to the Jew first, also to the Greek. So there's courage here that Paul is speaking of on his own behalf. I am not ashamed. I am willing to speak up. And who am I speaking to? Well, I'm speaking to the Jews, and what I'm speaking to them is a stumbling block. And I'm speaking to the Greeks, the Gentile world, and what I speak to them, that's foolishness. We don't need that. How could that possibly be? We can't follow that reasoning. But Paul says that this message is, in its inherent glory, it's a God life-giving message to a dying world. That's the message that Paul is carrying. I have a living message for a dying world. You're dying and don't even know it. I am speaking to you of salvation. Salvation. And so Paul despised any shame that might be connected with the gospel of Christ, either from the Jew or the Gentile. Anything that they would say, that's a message that we don't want. Paul says, I am the one who brings the message, and I am not ashamed of it. He's following in the footsteps of his Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ, who despised the shame, remember, according to the writer of the book of Hebrews. It is the power of God unto salvation. That's the theme of Paul's ensuing argument in the book of Romans. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. Notice what he says in verse 17 of Romans 1. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith, quoting from Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. The one overwhelming necessity of perishing men that they need is the salvation message. Salvation. Salvation is of God. It is a message that is filled with good news. It is the gospel message, and God owns that message. And the honor of God in carrying that proclamation of God's own power to save every soul that embraces it, Greek, barbarian, Jew, Gentile, doesn't matter who it is a message that will bring life. So we see it in the terms that God uses. In Mark chapter 16, if you'd turn there with me, please. In Mark 16, verse 14, afterward, now ask yourself, after what? We'll see it in a moment. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. Now back up with me to verse 9. Now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast 7 devils. And she went and told them that had been with him, as they mourned and wept. And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, notice these words, believed not. After that, he appeared in another form unto 2 of them as they walked and went into the country, the 2 on the road to Emmaus. And they went and told it unto the residue, neither believed they them. in Mark 16 and verse 15, he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. It is the verb form of that word that we're looking at, and it means to announce good news. It's not now speaking about the good news specifically, but it is the announcing of that good news, especially the gospel. It is declaring, bringing to someone else that good news, that glad tidings, that gospel of which God's word speaks. Now, all of this leads us to the third point. I have said that the scriptures indicate to us we should feed upon the word of God daily. So it ought to be a part of our appetite. It ought to be a part of our sustenance. It ought to be a part of our intake spiritually every day to feed upon the word of God. How do we do that? By reading God's word and meditating upon God's word. And then the thought that we are to heed God's word always. Pay attention to it. Be obedient to it. Respond to it in faith. But it leads us to this third point of we must seed, S-E-E-D, seed God's word at every opportunity. The word of God must be planted in the heart. It's not planted in the stomach. It's planted in the heart. That's the place for the intake of the sustenance that you and I need spiritually every day. For without it, we will fail. Without it, we will fall. Without it, we will falter. And so God calls upon us to take in, take in, take in the word of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Paul is writing to the Corinthian believers, and he is speaking to them about the fact that they have been on this journey in their minds to who's the best preacher? Who's the one that we really want to follow? Well, I'm of Paul. I'm of Apollos. I'm of Cephas. And so they select their favorites. And Paul says, who is Paul? Who is Apollos? Who is Cephas? 1 Corinthians 3, verse 5. Who then is Paul? And who is Apollos? But ministers, translate that, servants. Servants, by whom ye believed, even as the Lord gave to every man. Could you imagine a wealthy household? Concern yourself thinking about a Bill Gates or someone else of great money value, and in their home they argue over the servants. Well, I like him best. No, I like her best. Now, I want this one to serve me. Paul says, what are you doing? You're arguing over servants. That's all we are. We're just ministers by which the gospel message is made known. We have something that we need to do, but you're spending your time looking at the servants rather than seeing the service. What does he go on to say? I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one. And every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. You see, Apollos expressed in his own desire in Acts 18 and verse 27, was sent by the brethren to Corinth. And in Corinth, he followed up the work which Paul had begun. Paul had planted the gospel seed, and Apollos came along and watered the seed that had been sown. They were ministers, and ministers are nothing. We need to understand that. We make much of names, and we make much of men of godly character, and then when they fall and fail, we find ourselves in a tailspin because of what has taken place. Paul says, we're nothing. God is all in all. And we need to understand and appreciate God works by instruments, and he promises that the Holy Spirit is the one who faithfully uses the means of men to teach and preach the Word of God. We're living in an age when the Spirit of God's ministry is being carried on yet today in the hearts of individuals, and we are but instruments to express His Word so that it may take root in their hearts and they would grow. Of course, the classic expression of this need of planting, of seeding the Word of God, is found in what we read this morning in Matthew chapter 3, verses 3 through 9. He spake many things unto them in parables. And notice what he said, a sower went forth to sow. And then he describes what happened in the broadcasting of the seed. Now, don't look at a piece of farm equipment that was being used to broadcast this seed. It is a man walking through the field. He has the bag of grain, and it's about his neck so that it hangs down and he can reach in by the handfuls and begin to scatter the seed upon the ground so that it will bring forth. Some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth. They sprung up because they had no deepness of earth. They came up quickly. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. Some fell among thorns. And of course, the thorns sprung up and choked them. But others fell onto good ground and brought forth fruit, 100-fold, 60-fold, 30-fold. And then he gives this admonition, who hath ears to hear, let him hear. I want you to notice three things in the passage. There's the sower, there's the seed, and there's the soil. Three things that are needed in order for there to be any abundance of fruit coming forth. You have to have the sower, you have to have the seed, and you have to have the soil. All of those are required. It's interesting that we're told he spake many things unto them in parables. The word parable comes from two words, meaning one of them is para, meaning near, and valo, I cast or put something. So a parable is a comparison, a similitude in which one thing is compared with another, and especially spiritual things with natural things, by which means those spiritual things are better understood. So here was a story that our Lord told, a casting near something that would help them to understand what his message was, and it would make a deep and lasting impression on an attentive mind. That's what Adam Clark says in his commentary. Now, look at Matthew 13 again, verse 18, because our Lord gives an explanation. Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which received seed by the wayside. Here's what I really want you to catch, the Lord says. It's not just the picture of the sower and the seed and the soil, but there's something here spiritually you need to understand. But he that received the seed into stony places, the same as he that believeth the word, and anon with joy receiveth it, yet hath he not root in himself, but dureth for a while. For when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word, by and by he is offended. He also that received seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word, and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becometh unfruitful. There's so much to occupy the attention of the mind. But he that receiveth seed into the good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, which also beareth fruit and bringeth forth some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. There is a sense in which Luke's record of this particular incident also helps us. Luke chapter 8, verses 11 through 15. Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. Let that sink deeply into your hearts and minds this morning. The seed is the word of God. There's no question here. God is very clear. Christ is very clear. The seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear, then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. That's the whole purpose in the planting of the seed, that they might see, that they might believe, that they might be saved. They on the rock are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy, and these have no root, for which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away. And that which fell among thorns are they which, when they have heard, go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. But that on the good ground are they which, in an honest and good heart, have kept the word, have heard the word, kept it, and bring forth fruit with patience. Fruit with patience. What does the farmer do? He plants the seed, and he does the things that need to be done to care for that seed, trusting God for the rain, and he has patience to wait for the time of harvest. Patience has to be a part of the farmer's heart as he does these things. Notice with, if you will, the effect of the word is dependent on the state of the heart. We've all seen those who have heard the word of God and then it's quickly gone. Satan comes along and snatches it away. We've all seen those who, wow, look at that. They're so exuberant for the things of God. They seem to have a heart for this, and then in a short period of time, they're gone. We don't see them anymore. They're not concerned about spiritual things, and they have no heart for God. And we've seen those who have allowed the things of this world, the deceitful things, the despicable things, to draw them away from what they have heard and what they had professed to believe. And then, thank God, we have seen those where the word of God has taken root and it's been established well, and the roots have gone deep and the watering has been done, and they have responded to the gospel message and they continue on in that, and we delight in them over the years because we see them walking with God. But the state of the heart, the state of the heart will show us the effect of the word. The effect of the word is dependent on the state of the heart. Hard-packed, trodden down paths by the wayside, they won't receive the seed. It will lie upon the surface. It will do very little. They may think of it for a moment and then it's gone. The rock-filled, little shallow spots, but it can't last. It can't take root. I had Jonathan take a picture for me while we were in Montana near Yellowstone, and there was a plant that was growing out of a crevice right next to this huge rock, and I couldn't help but wonder, how long will that last? How long will it last? Because it was in a rocky place. And then thorn infested, choked with cares, choked with the riches and pleasures of this life, no fruit to perfection. And how often, dear friends, we allow our work, we allow our hobbies, we allow those things that we deeply appreciate in this life to interject themselves and to turn away from our walk with the Lord. In this instance, it was a turning away so that there was not even life that had been brought forth. And then good ground, an honest and a good heart to hear the word and to keep it and bring forth fruit with patience, so that we're reminded again, for us, lay the foundation. Feed on God's word daily. Heed God's word always. And then recognize that it is the word of God that will transform hearts and lives. It's not the persuasiveness of your argument with someone else. God tells you, God tells me, plant the seed. Plant the seed. Be a sower. Sow the seed. And put it on soil of hearts. No matter what that soil is, you can't determine the soil that you're planting that seed into. God will give the increase. God will bring about what is needed. It is the word of God that will transform hearts and lives, but the seed must be sown. It must be planted. You don't sow the seed, you're never going to get a crop. That's a sure thing. It needs to be then watered. And without that planting and watering, seed left in the bag or left in the bin is never going to bring forth life. So if you have the seed, and if you're a child of God, you do. You have the seed of the word of God, and it needs to be planted. If you leave it in the bag, if you leave it so that it's not a part of your heart and life, and you're not speaking out to others, it will not bring forth life. Remember what Paul said to the Jewish population in Romans, or said of them in Romans chapter 10, beginning in verse 8. He says, "But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart, that is the word of faith which we preach. that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now notice Paul's argument. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. God has sent you. God has sent me to proclaim his word, to proclaim salvation. You have opportunities every day to make that known. You have the opportunity to make it known to your own family, a mom and a dad to their children. You have the opportunity when you go to the grocery store, or stop in at the post office, or go to the bank, to speak to someone who has a heart's need, and to even in the quietness of the moment, and in such short, perhaps clipped ways, get the message of truth into their hearts. They need to hear the word of God. The seed needs to be sown. If you don't sow the seed, you'll get no crop. Life will not come. So seed the word of God at every opportunity. Be a sower of the good news. Take advantage of every opportunity. The words of Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 through 6 are meaningful here. Paul writes to the Colossian believers, continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving, with all praying also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I also am in bonds, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak, walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. Continue in prayer, and as you're doing that, pray for us, that is for myself and Timothy, Paul says. That's who he describes in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 1 as being the ones who bring this message. That God would open unto us a door of utterance, that is literally a door for the word. He's not asking here for the power of utterance, as he did in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 19. That's the petition there. Here he's praying or asking them to pray for the opportunity for preaching the word. You pray for us that we will have the opportunity to preach the word. What do you do when an opportunity arises? You take advantage of it. You step in. You say what needs to be said. And he says, we want to speak the mystery of Christ. What is the mystery of Christ? Colossians 1, verse 27 tells us, it is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you? How does Christ get into you? How does he get into the people to whom you speak? It is through the sowing of the seed, the word of God, proclaiming it, taking that opportunity with the clerk at the grocery store, with the person at the counter in the post office, with the people you meet upon the way and may never see again, but you share a gospel tract. You give them a little booklet that gives the message of salvation and calls upon them to put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. You look for opportunities. You ask God to help you to see with eyes that are spiritual eyes. Here's a person in need. Here's a person that I need to stop and pay attention to and give to them the message of truth. We're told that it's to be done in wisdom. Practical Christian prudence. And we're to give that word to those who are without. That's anybody who is outside of Christ. That's anybody whom we meet who does not know the Savior. To give that message, and we are to do it redeeming the time. That word redeeming is talking about buying up for yourselves. Buying up for yourselves. Buying up the opportunities. We buy up lots of things, don't we? Where we're quick to snatch up this, snatch up that. But God says, I want you to buy up. I want you to redeem opportunities. Don't let them get by you without speaking. And when the Spirit of God places on your heart, here is a person who needs to hear the truth of salvation. Ask God to give you the way, the means, the words to be able to say a word in season as to what they need to hear. Redeeming the time. So feed on God's word daily. Heed God's word always, and seed the word of God at every opportunity. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 and 16, and we'll close. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. See then that ye walk. It's literally take heed how you walk. Take heed how you walk. It's to be circumspectly. Circumspectly. A word that carries the thought of looking all around. It means to walk exactly. To walk diligently. Let your life be such that others will see Christ in you. Your life has to match your testimony. Let them see Christ in you. And he says, not as fools. The word is literally unwise. Not as unwise. And if you're not wise, you truly can be spoken of as a fool. But as wise, redeeming, buying up, ransoming, rescuing from loss the time. Because the days are evil. Friends, we are quick to talk about anything and everything under the sun. I know that some are more gregarious than others. I understand that. But think through your day or days. What occupies your words? What occupies your conversation? How much time is spent in giving forth anything that is of spiritual value? to the people around you. See how you walk. There's a double idea here. It's compressed into one sentence. See or take heed how you walk, and see that you walk circumspectly. Circumspectly. The manner in which you walk, as well as the act itself. See how you're walking, with a view to your being circumspect, accurate, exact in your walk. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without, and sow the seed. Sow the seed. You're a sower. God has given you seed, and he's placed soil all around you. You can't determine how the seed will be received, but you are responsible to sow the seed. That's the call that God gives to us. You need a sower, you need seed, you need soil. God has appointed us as sowers. He's given us the seed, and soil abounds on every side. So sow the seed, the gospel seed, the good news. Good news. That's what I have to give you. Good news. Let your speech be seasoned with salt. Oh, may God grant that we will be faithful in the sowing of the seed. Every opportunity that God gives. And when you miss an opportunity, take it to the Lord. Say, Father, I could have said so much more. I could have said something. I didn't say anything. But the opportunity was there. Let me not miss the next opportunity that comes to speak that word. And to do it in season, out of season, when it's convenient and when it isn't convenient. Let me preach, declare, proclaim the word. Jonathan, if you would please.
I invite you to take your hymnals, turn with me to hymn number 668 in closing, and we'll sing the first and the last stanzas of that song together. Hymn number 668, would you join with me in standing if you are able?
Thank you.
us where we have failed, sometimes so very miserably. But may we have our hearts girded with the strength of the Word of God, and having been appointed as witnesses, go ye into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. Ye shall be witnesses unto me, having been appointed as those who are to proclaim, to broadcast the seed. Oh, Father, help us to broadcast that seed upon the soil of the heart, whatever soil it may be, wherever it may be, knowing that in your time and in your way, there will be fruit that comes forth to the glory of God. Thank you, O Father. Thank you. May we be the recipients of your grace even today, and carry the message of truth for your glory and for the ransoming of the souls of men and women who are lost in sin. In Jesus' name we ask.
Amen.
Amen. Blessing.